The first time I attended SWIP was 2 years ago, also here in Hamburg. And in SWIP in Hamburg 2017, I gave a quick lightning presentation. I gave a preview of databibliotheca.nl. Further on, I'll just refer to it as the site or the platform to make pronunciation a bit easier, mixing two languages. So 2 years ago, I presented the site which we use to publish linked data as a preview. This presentation will be about the site and what preceded it. It will be about what happened since SWIP 2017 with the website, and most important, I think, it will be about our next plans to continue our and improve our linked data efforts at the KB. So, I was already introduced a bit. As was said, I am the product manager at the KB of an infrastructure that is somewhere in between our digital repository that we use for preservation and the services we build on the data that are in the repository. We have a system that provides services, for example, for websites, that provides services for scholars that want to use our data. And there's really a lot of data, specifically of digitized materials like newspapers, newspaper articles, books, etc. It's a huge amount of data. We provide it through services like OAI PMH, for example. There are search interfaces, and it's not only metadata, but it's also digital objects, OCR text, images, altos, etc. I think it's a very cool set of data, but one of the downsides of the current situation is that its metadata has organically grown over the years, and we've been running it for about 10 years or so now, so there are many inconsistencies in the data, and much has not been documented, it's not really standard, so, but that's what I'm at. So now we go to linked data. The KB started a project to publish linked data the project started in December 2015, and the main goal or the main collection that we aimed to publish as linked data was the Dutch National Biography. And yeah, why? Maybe it's a strange question to ask on a semantic web conference, but I think something we often said, should you use linked data, is this phrase, and I guess it's a quote, but I tried to Google who said this. Maybe we said it, but it's probably a quote. Does anybody know who said to be in the web instead of just on the web? Is that Tim Berners-Lee or somebody else? Or? Oh, I'm sorry. He's there. I thought of you. I was going to name you second, but thank you, Herbert van Sompel. Okay, sorry, it has to be in the web instead of just off the web. Yeah, am I correct? Okay, well, at least the goal was to facilitate others to use and reuse and link to the KB metadata and eventually also the KB digital objects. So, before we started doing actual work, we started thinking about some principles to follow, some semantic and design principles. Like I already said, the goal was initially to start with publishing bibliographic metadata, and the KB already had set an horizon for its bibliographic metadata, and that horizon is that eventually all bibliographic metadata of the KB should adhere to the IFLA library reference model standards. And as you probably know, that's the hierarchy of work, expression, manifestation, and item. So that was a design principle we wanted to follow. But yeah, of course, our catalog still has a long way to go before it gets there. We use a CBS catalog, and the catalogers use Pika Plus to catalog in it. So that's really a long way from IFLA LRM ontology. And the records we have in our current cataloging system, they are more or less, you could say, equivalent to manifestations in IFLA library reference model terms. So we decided, well, for now we just start publishing manifestations derived from our catalog records. And we also decided to use the schema.org vocabulary as the core vocabulary wherever possible, because when you go to the web nowadays, you can't, everything is done in schema.org. Maybe it's not the best vocabulary, but everybody understands it. It's, and one of the aims of the whole project is to make our library data as accessible as possible for others. So we thought that would be a wise choice. Further, we already had some RDF in our systems, in our OHIPMH system. We had some RDF, SCOS RDF, for our thesauri. And SCOS is a great standard, but I think it's a great standard for things that are in essentially concepts, things like economic growth, it's a concept, or love, that's a concept. But I think persons, you can of course describe a person or an organization as a concept, but we thought it would be better to discuss those entities and make them into schema persons or schema organizations. Further, we created a URI policy, and one of the core things of the URI policy is that we decided to follow the best practice to distinguish between the thing we describe and the description of the thing. So both have a different URI. Not everybody follows that practice, but we wanted to follow it. So further, the technology, we already had some experience participating in hackathons, in Hackalot, for example, and we worked together with an external IT partner. And he always used LotView and Virtuoso Open Source Triple Store as the foundation. And we worked closely together with this organization. So for our effort, we also decided to use those tools. However, for the things we intended to do, we couldn't just do an out-of-the-box install of LotView and Virtuoso. Because to implement our URI policy, to distinguish between things and descriptions of things, we had to implement some extra redirect and content negotiation rules. And we used the Apache web server for that. And eventually, now it runs more or less as we intended it. So now we had design principles, we had a technical foundation. So we had to create the RDF, and that was that turned out to be a lot of work. As you can see in this slide, we used various routes to create the RDF for various sets, for various collection, depending on the tools we had at hand, depending on the nature of the material at hand, or perhaps maybe even depending on our mood. We were and are still experimenting what's the best route to take. For example, like I said, the thesauri were already in SCOS RDF, so we already had them in RDF. We simply loaded those in a triple store and used Sparkle constructs to translate the SCOS to schema.org RDF. That was fairly simple. Another simple data set was in a relational database that ran PHP. So a developer created a PHP script that simply created RDF from the relational database. That was quite simple. But the most interesting and most complex stuff was the core of all the bibliographic records we wanted to publish. And like I said, we catalog in PKAP Plus, which is quite an outdated standard, if you ask me. We wanted to modernize the PKAP Plus, and the first step we did was to, using XSLT processing, we converted PKAP Plus to PKAP Plus in an RDF format, but in a very weird semantically completely incorrect format. It was just RDF reflecting the structure of the PKAP records. Semantically completely nonsense, but it had all the structural information of the PKAP records, and of course the names of the PKAP fields. So then we had RDF, which we could load into a triple store. And in the triple store, we could use Sparkle constructs to create the actual RDF we wanted to create and we wanted to publish. Initially, that worked fairly good until we wanted to use this procedure, this approach, to also create blank notes in our data. And that, for some reason, Virtuoso had a lot of problems creating blank notes. So we had to slim down this procedure. We couldn't process all our data in one batch. We had to slice it into pieces of about 1% of all our data, and that way Virtuoso managed to also create all the blank notes for us. So that's how we created the bibliographic records. Our latest efforts in creating RDF from bibliographic records follow a different route. Also starts with the Pika Plus, of course. But now we have a continuous running, more or less continuous running, well, batch process that loads into a relational database that reflects the structure of the Pika. And from that relational database, it's much easier to export the RDF in the format we wanted to have. So we use stored procedures and XSLT, and it simply spits out the triples we want to load in our triple store. Okay, this is what it looks like. It's quite similar to what I showed 2 years ago, but now there's a lot more data sets. This is the homepage. This list is generated dynamically using a Sparkle query. Now we go a bit deeper into a dataset description. You see, indeed, we use schema.org a lot, but also other vocabularies when we thought it would be smarter to use those. Perhaps not always the most wise choice, but yeah, that's how you learn. Here we see a part of a bibliographic record in schema.org. Okay, but that's more or less where we were at 2 years ago also. Interesting thing is, what have we learned by doing this? I already talked about creating RDF. That can be really problematic. It's not easy to do. It's something you want to be as automatic as possible, and we haven't managed to do that yet. And one of the things that's holding us is the conversion process is quite complex, because ancient formats aren't simply to be converted one-to-one to linked data formats. You always get very complex style sheets or very complex logic that has to be followed to convert all the data. And also the data is quite, some data records are quite ancient and the data is inconsistent. You probably all recognize when you know bibliographic records. So ideally, to automate this, it would be perfect if the bibliographic system would be, in a way, linked data aware. I don't think a bibliographic system has to be based on triples or has to be based on RDF itself, but at least the model behind it should be mappable to the models we want to use in our linked data environment, and we're not there yet. But now I'm only talking about the catalog, but there's also data from other systems we want to publish. And the same goes, of course, for those systems. The data in those systems, it should be mappable to RDF also. But even more, when we have different systems, we want to be able to interconnect those systems and to know when this system talks about resource A, is it the same resource as the other system talks about? So basically what we need is more or less a unified data model for all the data we have at the KB, all the data we want to publish at the KB. So that's the thing we are working on. I'll talk about that later a bit more. And then the other thing I want to talk with you about is the thing that we didn't think of when we started, or not really, is that when you publish linked data, you have to decide which vocabulary to use, etc. It's a good thing when you have more choices, when you don't have to just use schema.org, when it's also possible to use other serializations or ontologies, for example. So now we are working on a unified model for all our metadata. And since the horizon for bibliographic metadata has been defined by the KB as IFLA LRM, we're using that for the bibliographic metadata, but we have also a lot of metadata which refers to digital objects. And we want to use the Library of Congress Preservation Metadata Initiative, I think it's called, Premise. We want to use Premise as the entity model, and we want to connect that to the IFLA model. And when you look at this picture, it seems fairly straightforward, but one might ask, is it correct to say that an intellectual entity, which is referred to by Premise, is that really the same as an item in IFLA LRM? it's a choice we want to make and we want to try out. Perhaps it works, perhaps it won't work, we'll see. Another complexity behind this seemingly simple picture is our questions like, for example, when we have a representation, for example, an EPUB document, and we want to convert that to another format and create a new representation, does that create also a new item, or can we say it's the same item? I think many catalogers will say it creates a new item, but perhaps that's not a handy approach. So that's one of the things we need to discuss before we can start up with this model. Also, when we want to use IFLA LRM, we can't just say we publish manifestations. We also want to publish expressions and works. So we have to cluster our records into those higher levels, into expression levels and work levels. And that's quite an undertaking. So we are now experimenting with tools we are creating ourselves to generate works and expressions. That's the RDA Entity Finder. And my colleague Joke is giving a lightning talk this afternoon, I guess, about the RDA Entity Finder we use. Okay, the second issue we are working on now is, well, when we just started creating RDF and linked data, we followed a very naive model. A book has an author, very simple, one-to-one relation. But beginning this year, we started a project together with the University of Amsterdam, amongst others, Golden Agents. And for them, this relation was way too simple because they also wanted to know what name did an author use in context of this publication. And you can't use the very simple naive model for that. So we tried to figure out how can we solve that issue using schema.org. And we came up with a construction using schema role. So in the schema role, we used the name that was used actually in the context of the given presentation. And it's a somewhat weird construction. I think it's typically for schema.org to use such a in-between step, but it works out very well for us. But we wanted to know, okay, this works nice in schema.org. Will it also work in LRM and RDA? Does it work in LRM and RDA? How do you model such a thing in LRM and RDA? So we tried to figure it out, and we came to a solution, but I don't think we are completely satisfied with it. We think we can link a manifestation in LRM to a nomen, which relates to a person. That sounds logical. But a bit of problem we have is that the link between the manifestation and the nomen, we didn't find a right property that's specific enough. We now just use a very generic related nomen, but it could mean anything. Ideally, we would use something like a related author nomen or something, and that isn't there. We could create it, of course, ourselves, subclass it or so. But so now, for some use cases, it's ideal to have a very naive representation of your data. For others, you want a more complex representation of your data using schema role, for example. And eventually, we also want to publish our data as LRM and RDA, of course. So we need in our publication environment a way to present different representations of the metadata. And that's a thing we want to work on next year. So when I look up a book, by default, I get redirected to the simple schema.org representation, but the schema.org representation will tell me, hey, we have this book also in an RDA LRM representation, or perhaps even more representations. So this is my conclusion. Yeah, it was a bit implicit in my presentation, but it's a good thing to end with. We started doing linked data for the end user, but I haven't talked about the end user at all. I haven't even researched the end user. I haven't talked to him. I don't know what he thinks about it. But for us as an organization, it was very useful to start working on linked data and modeling because it helped us to rethink our metadata and to see a way out of, to say it bluntly, out of our metadata chaos we have created over the years because of our organically grown metadata. So that has been very useful. And another useful spin-off is also that it forces us as an organization to cooperate. It forces enforces cooperation between the catalog department and more IT-based departments. So that was also a very good spin-off. My final remark is a bit more, less optimistic. There are a lot of tools available, but none of the tool will be perfect for for the work you want to do. The world isn't mature yet in that respect. So, thank you.
Thank you. And now we have time for some questions, so bring them on.
Hello, I'm Osmo Suomi in the National Library of Finland. Thank you for a great talk. I'm interested in, actually two things. One is you mentioned at the very end that you didn't actually, you were starting off with users but didn't actually think about it that much during the project. Do you know who your users are of the service and what they are using it for? And just a second quick question, do you have a Sparkle endpoint? And if so, how do you handle those multiple representations like simple schema, extended schema? LRM.
Yeah. Like I said, we don't know much about the user, but it's not completely true because the Golden Agents project we talked about, they wanted to use our linked data, and we were creating linked data, so we started talking with them. How do you want this linked data to be modeled? How do you want it to be? So we worked closely together with them, and they are end users of our data. So we do work together with. But this is the only good example I can give you. And indeed, we do have a Sparkle endpoint. And your question is, how would multiple representations work together with a Sparkle endpoint? Our idea is, and it's not ideal, but it's feasible, to have each representation in a different graph. So that would create quite huge graphs, but we guess it will be workable. Not ideal, but workable.
Questions? All right. And while we are asking questions, there was a question there and okay here. Please, the next presenters, go check that you can.
Okay, I'm Ricardo from Spain. My question is if you have considered changing the way you produce metadata. I mean, moving from Pika as a native linked data system, whatever it is. I mean, eliminating the first step of your conversion, creating data not in Pika but in RDF Stride.
Eventually, we would like to end up in a catalog system that would be based on a different standard. So, a lot of work we are doing now is investigating how we can map all the Pika records to RDA. That's what we're working on. When we have structured it in RDA, it will be much easier, we hope, to move to a different system. And I hope there will be systems on the market by them that will be based on LRM. It might end up as BibFrame, perhaps, but I think the work we did already in structuring our data will be very helpful. And it will be a lot of work, I guess, to end that.
All right, one more question, perhaps. Mic not working?
Is it working?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. thank you. I'm Carole Melzac from ABES France, and I also have a question about Pika Plus, because it sounds very familiar to us when we are using OCLC CBS as an infrastructure for our union catalog. But we have a shared cataloging system, and our catalogers use MARC. So indeed, we store Pika Plus, but know that we are considering moving to something else. We do not use the Pika Plus as a basis. We think MARC. So my question was, do you focus on Pika Plus because it's the native format, or do you have a MARC view, or how?
Pika Plus is indeed our native format, and I know there are MARC views available in our system, but I don't think they are reliable enough to be used as a base. So most work we do, we use Pika Plus for. Our experts know Pika Plus very well, so we use Pika Plus for everything. That's why we use it also in this situation.
Thank you for questions.
Thanks again.
And we move on.